Hello everyone and welcome to the new Sankofa flight that takes off for a short flight from Sharpeville yesterday to the Ndongo Kingdom, i.e. Angola in the 16th century. We arrive in this territory at the same time as the Portuguese, who have upset the local context with the wars of conquest, the development of the slave trade, and the emergence of a new economic market that have upset the social, economic, cultural, and political landscape in the region. We are going on an official visit to Her Excellency Queen Nzinga Mbandi, Queen of Ndongo and Matamba Kingdom. A fine diplomat, a skilled negotiator, a formidable strategist, a remarkable example of women governance, who opposed strong resistance to the Portuguese colonial project and until her death in 1663, marking the history of the 17th century Angola.
African History Daily by my daddy.
Central Africa in the 16th century is made up of different kingdoms, first and foremost the Great Congo Kingdom, but also small kingdoms such as the Ndongo and Matamba, which gradually emancipated themselves from the Great Congo. At the time, the structure of political organization are relatively common. They are based on a central power and intermediate levels, which in Ndongo, for example, are called the sobas or chiefs. The economic exchanges between the different kingdoms allow the circulation of complementary products, in particular between the coast and the interior of the lands. These include in particular iron, ivory, fabrics, salt, fishery products, agricultural and livestock products. In Ndongo Kingdom, the central power, traditionally transmitted by lineage, is located inland at the junction of trade routes for a better control. As early as the beginning of the 15th century, the Portuguese and Spanish large expedition to conquer new territories around the world. Regarding Angola, in 1575, the Portuguese navigator and conquistador Paulo Dias de Novais founded the port city of São Paulo de Assunção de Luanda, today called Luanda, capital city of the present-day Angola. From 1580, the Portuguese intensified the slave trade, started the war against the Ndongo Kingdom, and launched an assault to the entire country. They progressed in stages inland, from forts erected along the Kwanza River. The construction of a fort called Ambaka in 1611 brought them closer to the capital of Ndongo, about 250 kilometers from the coast. The massive slave trade in Luanda from the end of the 16th century had a considerable impact on local population and kingdom and continued until the middle of the 19th century. Rooted in catches, wars, raids and local markets, millions of children, millions of women and millions of men have been deported to Brazil, Central America and Portugal. The Ndongo resistance, embodied in particular by Nzinga Mbandi, slowed down Portuguese projects. This woman of power relied not only on her art of war and guerrilla warfare, but also her spying tactics and her great negotiating skills. Initially appointed ambassador in Luanda by her brother Ngola Mbandi in 1622, Nzinga managed to negotiate peace with the Portuguese governor. It is after the death of her brother that she took power. Over the decade, she weaved multiple strategic alliances with the neighboring kingdoms, negotiated with the Portuguese and the Dutch, and took under her protection the population who joined her kingdom. She opposed strong resistance to the Portuguese and gradually emerged as a powerful regional political figure, unavoidable, often feared, and never subjected. So Nzinga never accepted the loss of Ndongo. Even as a refugee in Matamba, she signed her correspondence with the title of Nzinga Mbandingola, that is Queen of Ndongo and Matamba. Economically, she also organized the circulation of various commercial products between the two regions, selling domestic animals, fish, textile fibers, oil and palm wine, first contributing to the formation of quitandas, those popular market and important economic and social spaces where women play a vital role. Despite numerous attempts to capture her, Nzinga managed to thwart all the plots against her until her death in 1663, after which 7,000 of her soldiers were captured and sent to Brazil as slaves. From then on, the Portuguese occupation accentuated towards the interior of the land in order to feed the slave trading business. My African cliché of the day is an obsession, one that makes me wonder every day what would be the reaction of the Portuguese school children in year 5 and 4 if the history teacher taught them that one day the ancestors arrived on this African territory and decided to submit it by massacring women and children, mostly, as they said, in the name of religion and the love of God, and also a little bit as well in the name of their economic interest. What will the Portuguese children say in front of such magnificent actions? It's up to you to tell me what you think about that, and I hope to see you tomorrow for the next flight on the Sankofa. Thank you.